my pleasure to welcome you all to the third talk in the 2017 Gibbons Lecture Series. For those that don't know me, I'm Jill Dobby, here in the Department of Computer Science at the University of Auckland. Our speaker today is Marcus Frean. Marcus is from Victoria University in Wellington. I wondered, you know, how long he'd been working in the neural net area, so of course I Googled, and his most cited paper is a paper about a method for constructing and training feed-forward neural networks, and it was published in 1990. So, you know, while people think this is all new stuff, Marcus has been at the forefront. His research is driven by the challenge of making computers learn by themselves and the continuing mystery of how brains achieve the same things. So hopefully you're going to touch on some of this evening.
Hopefully. We'll see. Hi. Thanks for having me. It's great to be here. What a pleasure. So what's missing is a large country. It's a big place. And I realised that I've thrown myself a hospital pass when I was asked by Bob what title I should give back in December, whenever you first approached me. And I say, oh, deep learning, let's say what's missing. That was my first mistake, because obviously I can't, if I knew what was missing, it wouldn't be missing anymore. So I've done the whole girdle thing straight off the bat. But I'm going to pick up on a couple of specific things that I feel are missing. I'm going to partially fill in one of them, and the others just, you know, question marks to plant in your head. And I'll mention towards the end some other aspects that I think are just, holes. They're really mostly holes in understanding in the current world of deep learning. So what is this deep learning? Let's get right into it, eh? Something's happening in machine learning. If you can read that, it says hype watch, big data, saturating on the hype curve. And the red guy coming up there is machine learning. And I guess the question is this big beginning of a, how big is this curve going to go? Well, what's going to happen? Not just in hype, but in terms of application, success, stuff. Is it going to plateau, or are we just in early days? And it's hard to know, because there's a lot going on. So this curve is, there's a lot of things behind it. There's some new insights, some wonderful ideas. And then at the same time, there's applications to those ideas that are very worthwhile doing, and therefore big corporates jumping in into the space that used to be occupied by universities, and huge resources pouring in, and then more ideas flowing from that. So we're in that exponential phase there, and who knows where we're going. But I think part of the excitement is driven by, let's get rid of that hand. By recently, I'm talking the last just couple of years, machines achieving near human performance on certain selected tasks, right? And those tasks being spread across the spectrum from image recognition to speech recognition, text translation, gameplay, dot, dot, dot. You'll have your own things you've read about in the press. And so these are exciting, and they're also slightly frightening. I love this sentence from the listener in April. I read it out. It's about to get worse. The job-sucking behemoth of artificial intelligence stalks the horizon. And I just think it's beautiful, you know. Stalking the horizon, this silhouette of the job-sucking artificial intelligence. And so that's scary, and there are aspects that we should be thinking about. I think that some things are a little scary. There's also, of course, tons of promise. There's enough promise that lots of academics want to jump in on the game. In particular, this phenomenon of deep learning, which is the subject of my talk, is the part of machine learning that's actually driving the red curve up, the hype curve. All these achievements that are close to human-level performance are deep learners. And everyone's saying, oh, yeah, of course, I've been doing deep learning forever. I don't know if you have colleagues like that, but... Okay, so let's just get into this. What's a neural net? So deep learners are... what it means is big neural nets. talks, and probably if you're in a talk like this, you probably know what a neural net is. But here's a neural net. It's what we have is a bunch of input features or values, so that forms a vector. Let's turn them all on. A vector of input values and some target output. In this case, there are two outputs. And in between, we're going to have a bunch of neurons. What's a neuron? That's a little unit that takes a weighted sum of its predecessors in the previous layer, computes the weighted sum, and then pushes that through a very simple non-linearity. So if you like, let's make this thing go. Let's give it a problem, a hard problem, make it go. Okay, so what you see on the right there is that little diagram there, if you can see it. That's the loss, that's the error of the network as it attempts to try to get to grips with this learning problem I've given it, which is actually a pretty tough one, to learn to classify the data points on the spiral. All right, so what's happening here is there's a learning algorithm which is changing the connections between all these neurons. Okay, that's all that's happening. The function, the non-linearity is staying the same. The inputs are coming from some training set of examples and outputs, an output pattern that goes with each input pattern. And it's simply learning the mapping from the input to the output. Okay, with some success, it's still going. Okay.
Fine.
So that's what a neural network is. I should say there's another part of this red curve rising is a bunch of new fantastic tech being built, including TensorFlow, that demonstration there. But here's my more reduced picture. This is my shorthand for that last picture of what a neural network looks like that I'll use for other bits of the talk. So we have an input, that's a vector, that blue line, and an output, another blue line vector. I hope you can see that. It's a little bit, apparently we can't sort of dim the lights to halfway. It doesn't work like that. But anyway, so input through to output, and it's going through each of these trapezoid, something, four-sided thing, is representing a weights matrix, so all the weights from one layer to the next. And then the sigma in a circle is representing that non-linearity. So we have the weights matrix happening, and then element-wise non-linearity happening. And that's all a neural network is, okay? And it's deep if you're stringing a bunch of these together. It's deep if you make more than three layers. You're allowed to say deep, I think. In the old days, you could say that. And now we can train things that are hundreds of layers deep. Okay, so how do we train it? We look at the error. So each input pattern has a desired output. You stick in the input, something else comes out, not the desired output, so there's an error. We can compute the gradient of the difference between them, a loss function. Compute the gradient of that and push that back through the network. And that's basically just saying, how would I like to change some parameter inside this matrix, some weight value, how would I like to change it such that the performance on the training set has fewer errors? Error back propagation, it's often called. It's an old algorithm from the 80s. Okay, so that's a neural net. Game over, really. Okay, so here's an example of a neural net, a reasonably deep one. It's take the input, this blue vector here is an image. That could be just a huge vector, right? It's pretty big, hundreds and hundreds of elements. But an image is a vector. It's going through this neural net. Don't worry about the details here. And out is coming out the far side at the output. In this case, labels, words, like car, truck, airplane, ship, horse. And in this case, you know, thankfully it's figured out that this thing is more likely to be a car than a horse, so full marks. And it did that by training on probably millions of pictures of cars. Okay, so all the weights in this big neural net have been trained by this algorithm. Okay, that's deep learning. Awesome. That wasn't too hard, was it? I should tell you about a particular kind of neural network, which is known as an autoencoder, which is being used in very interesting ways these days. So an autoencoder, what you do is you take the input and you push it through the neural net, and you train it to reproduce the input at the output. So the target is just the input. It's called an autoencoder. Why on earth would we want to do this, right? The identity map does this. It's not that hard to get the input from the input. But if we push it through a neural net, and there's a layer in here that's this very narrow, a little blue dot in the middle there. Sorry, I'm being very rightist here. So if we go through that bottleneck layer, then what's the neural network trying to do? It has to push this picture of a car through the network and recover car picture at the far side. But along the way, it's got to go through this really skinny layer in the middle. Imagine that was only 2 units, just to be really nasty. That means it's got to push it down to a two-dimensional vector, which represents that car. And it's obviously pretty tricky, right? But perhaps you can imagine that those two dimensions are going to be pretty interesting features of CARD and of the training set, if you can achieve it. It's hard to achieve, but if you can do it, it's pretty interesting. Okay, so here's just another picture of the same sort of thing. How would you make use of this? So here's an example where this is a different kind of picture. Each dot here on the left is a data point. So I'm just schematically representing a vector, picture of a car. They're being pushed through this network just like before, and out is coming an output, and I'm learning to match that output to the input. And so the output is going to be really a distribution. And along the way, it's being forced through right down into just 2 dimensions, say, or a very low-dimensional version. So each dot here actually has its own little dot down the two-dimensional space, right? And then it recovers back and you get the car back. So each dot, the precise position of the dot, means a lot. Okay, so now I can imagine you move, I can just pick a dot here and I can make a car picture. Or I could move on a line through that sort of central, through this compressed representation. As I move along through that line, what do I get? I get different pictures of cars and they'll change, probably in some discernible way. So let's forget cars and do it with faces instead. This is my colleague Tom White from Victoria's Design School, actually. Let's see if I can do this. Good, okay. So I'll just go straight to the horse's mouth. He's looking at, let's look at the earlier one first. So this is almost literally that two-dimensional picture of little dots. And as we move, you pick a dot in the two-dimensional space and go and make a face from it. So the whole network has been learning faces. Millions of faces and faces and faces, it seems. So it knows about faces. You pick a dot here, you get a face. As you move along a line, the faces change. Okay, so that's exactly what I was saying is happening here. And you can see what's happening. You know, there are significant, semantically, or I don't know, there are recognizable things happening as you move through this two-dimensional space. And here he's made it more than two-dimensional, and he's holding two of them fixed and moving on a third one. And it seems to be the the concept vector for receding hairline is what he says. Loads of fun. So these generative models, I guess what I'm really saying is these generative models are really interesting beasts, and that we've recently started to get really good at this. So for a long time, it was all about supervised learning to classify pictures of cars, maybe cats, you know, things. And now people are moving on to the unsupervised learning problems, which means building generative models. And I just want to show you a couple of other powerful generative models here. You've probably heard of DeepArt. DeepArt's great fun. You can put your own photo into this and have it converted into a style. So if you take a network that's been trained on a particular style, and then you put a real alternative image in as the input, what does it do? It tries to turn, it pushes it through this bottleneck, and then tries to recover the pattern, but it's going to recover a pattern that's like the ones it's seen in its training set. So heaps of fun. This one, what is that? Let's skip that. This is the one that doesn't work, right? I've got to find the other browser. Where are you? There you are. Okay. So this is just a piece of fun. So this application of that general idea of generative models takes a sketch and turns it into a picture, which is an extraordinary thing to do, isn't it? I mean, I hope you can agree that's just an amazing thing for a machine to be able to do. Of course, if you give it something that's different,
It'll get a bit, let's just move the tail over a bit. Okay. Yeah, new tail, that's great. So this learned model knows about cats. So that's great if you have a sketch of a cat. Unfortunately, if you don't have a sketch of a cat, I don't know. It's a little alarming, the sort of things you can do. You can have a lot of fun with this, right? Let's get rid of the eyeballs. It's going to have to put the eyeballs somewhere. You know it's going to happen because you can't have a cat without eyeballs. Yeah, fun, eh? So I don't know. This is a toy. There are some obvious money-making applications, but there's a whole heap of fun also out there for in this world of generative models. So I'm a big fan. Top picture there is a picture of bathrooms. This is a net that has seen a lot of bathrooms in its time from the interweb, and it's now fantasizing bathrooms. So those are all fake bathrooms. And that's totally extraordinary. This is April this year. Before that, you got blurry things that you might be able to imagine with bathrooms. Now they really look like bathrooms. So I think this is interesting from the point of view of we've all kind of got used to the idea of machines talking to us, you know, automated voices, call centers, and so on. And to some extent, we're used to auto-generated text. But we're entering this world where we're going to have a lot of auto-generated imagery, it seems, coming at us. And for a species that is so visually dominant, it's I don't know. That's an interesting challenge, isn't it? I think it's going to mess with us a bit. Okay, now I want to talk about something that's missing in this picture. So that's all that stuff is really being achieved with these really quite straightforward technology underneath. There's lots of tricks and, you know, learning, of course, but essentially the engine is these deep neural nets. And they are trained by this error propagation algorithm. Okay. So there's a fundamental learning problem identified in 1991 by Schmidhuber and his PhD student, Hochreiter. And they were confident enough to call this the fundamental deep learning problem. And it's called vanishing or exploding gradients. So what happens, I take an error signal and I start pushing the gradient of the loss, the gradient of the difference between the output and the target. Okay, I start pushing that back through the network. And what happens is these signals that are passing back through the network tend to have a very strong tendency either to blow up and start becoming infinite or to shrink down to tiny, tiny values. And this isn't a minor problem. You might think, oh, we just use lots of floating point arithmetic and we'll be fine. No, it's a real explosion or a real vanishing. It comes down to linear algebra, eigenvalues. Let's not go there. It's a ubiquitous feature of trying to do this task of propagating the gradients. Okay, so this is really supposedly solved by a bunch of things. For one thing, you replace sigmoids in the old school neural nets of my youth with rectified linear functions. Rectified linear just says if I'm a neuron and my total input is negative, I output a zero. If it's positive, then I output just whatever the positive sum was I was receiving. Simple as that. Really dumb. And that works really well. They work really fine. So that's part of the trick. Very careful initialization of the weights can help a lot here. And a technique called batch normalization, which is basically just trying to keep these activations to have about the right mean and about the right variance all the time, constantly rescaling and shifting them to keep them in the right ballpark. Okay, it kind of makes sense, right? Took a long time for someone to make it really work, but it makes intuitive sense. Those all help. They really solve that problem. Okay, so here's the thing. I reckon there's another fundamental problem. And this is work with David Balduzzi, he's really the lead creative on all this. There's another fundamental problem to learning in deep nets. It's not the exploding or vanishing, we call it shattering. David's term. So we've just written a paper called The Shattered Gradients Problem. And the title says it all. If resonance are the answer, what's the question? I'll tell you about resonance in just a second. So here we go, resonance. So residual nets are, as of last year, the king. They're the state of the art in classifying images, things in images, for example. Very, very effective. And they allow you to learn very, very deep nets, hundreds and hundreds of layers deep. This is great. What's the trick? We replace, instead of just having this straight feed-forward connection through to weights matrices, you insert these little hop-over direct connections, which are just the identity map. And why would that make any difference? Well, if you drew it differently, so you've just got basically the identity map as the short route going through, and these are all hopping out to do a bit more work. So you can imagine it's a bit like replacing a, well, it is actually replacing the old feed-forward function with X, the input, minus the new feed-forward function. So the nonlinearities in the weights matrices are working on the residual. They're fixing up the errors. But there's this backbone of very direct connections. Okay, so for whatever reason, this is a really good idea. Lots of varieties of it, but basically let's call them residual nets or resnets. They work really well. Okay, so it was originally said that they were helping with this explosion or vanishing gradient problem. But if that's true, why are they working so well now in these deep nets? Because really that problem was solved by these other techniques. So they're doing something else, these skip connections. They're solving some other problem. All right, what do you think it could be? Maybe it pays to just have a look at some gradients. So here's a really simple neural net. It's got two layers. And this is what I'm doing is plotting. It's a really simple net. So it has one input, it's a scalar input. It has every hidden layer has 100 hidden nodes in it, and they've all got these rectified linear ReLUs in them. And then it ends up, the output is just a single scalar as well. So scalar to scalar, X to Y, which is great because I can just plot it. And we're doing back propagation on this network. So here's a picture of the gradient as I move along the X. I'm being rightist again. As I move the input value from 0 to 1, say, how does the gradient change? The gradient I would calculate at the first layer. And it steps along. It's a Manhattan skyline. It's got flat bits. That's because of these ReLU functions. But let's look at the overall shape. It jumps around. It's sort of a random walk, right? Below it is a random walk, otherwise known as brown noise. A random walk, someone staggering down the road, right? Left, right, oh God. So one of the things we've shown is that in the limit of an infinite number of hidden units, this is a random walk, there's the same distribution. Okay, that's two layers. Here's what 20 layers looks like with this batch normalization thing, which is solving the whole exploding gradient problem. This is 20 layers neural net. That's white noise. Random white, totally uncorrelated white noise. Okay, so that's what we mean by shattered. The gradient is being shattered into tiny, tiny, tiny pieces that are completely unrelated to their neighbors. And you can start to imagine what that would do to a learner. So how can you learn when the gradient information, which is the learning signal, looks like that? You can't. All right. Here's what ResNet looks like. It's somewhere in between. It's not brown noise, and it's not white noise. It's somewhere in between. It's got local structure, but it's not just a straight line either. All right. So here's our idea. Here's the intriguing facts, actually. The gradients of a deep feed-forward net look like white noise. Wow. That's only 20 layers. Imagine when you get to 200. And resnets don't shatter. Their gradient does not get shattered. All right, so let's look at some more pictures. This is what I'm looking at is, if as I go left to right along one of these lines, the black and white lines, I'm just saying, is this neuron, here's a neuron in a hidden layer, is its activation on? I mean, is it outputting a real value other than zero, or is it outputting zero? I know that's what black and white means. I guess just don't worry about the colored ones. Look at these hashy pictures there. Okay, so they all look the same at the two-layer level. Fine. You go to 10 layers, things are starting to change. Let's go all the way to the 50 layers. At 50 layers, what's happening? We should be able to understand this. The planned feed-forward network, pretty much all the neurons are either on all the time or off all the time. That's what actually what the histograms are showing in the blue there. Neurons are either active or they're totally inactive. In other words, they're just being linear, which is not very helpful, or they're dead, they're outputting zero. Neither of these things is contributing any computation to the mapping that we're trying to learn. So that's no good. A feed-forward network with batch normalization, the shattering has broken up the activity, so every neuron's pretty much uncorrelated to the different points of the input. So if I vary the input, any one of these neurons is flicking on and off all the time, pretty much randomly. It's not random, it's deterministic, but it looks random. And the ResNet's somewhere in between. So that's nice. We can prove theorems. So we can talk about the covariance as we move along the x direction. What's the covariance in the gradient, actually, at different points? And you can prove that it dies away 1 over 2 to the power of the number of layers. So it's exponentially dying away. A covariance of 0 means there's no signal left. You have totally white noise. No connection between neighboring points in the input space, basically, as far as the learner is concerned. Which makes the problem as unlearnable. ResNets go the other way. They actually rise, but it's only a slow rise, so square root of the layer, number of layers. Really different characteristics. So what's going on? Shattering is occurring as a feature of deep learning. It's a really important thing. It actually stops you learning things. One way to solve it is to have these skip connections. So that's really what the skip connections are doing. Okay, so with this insight, it was a nice payoff immediately to come up with a new initialization. You know, understanding something provokes further ideas. And so we came up with a new initialization. This is a student, Lennox Leary, which enables us to train really deep nets of up to 200 layers and hundreds of hidden units per layer, so really deep, without any skip connections at all. So that's the first time anyone's trained a network that deep without using skip collections, and skip connections essentially reduce the depth. Okay, so I like this. We've attracted that Reddit page, which is awesome. And one of the comments on that there sums it up really nicely. So we really don't understand how to train neural nets, do we? This is just such a basic thing, right? Fundamental aspect that's just coming to light, really. Okay, I want to switch tack to the other flavor of neural nets. So we've been talking about deep neural nets as feed-forward enterprises. They go from input to output. People are really interested in modeling structure and time and modeling sequences. And you can do that with neural nets that are very similar with one difference. So the idea is we allow the hidden layer to feed back on itself. It makes a first-order Markov system out of the device, if you like. So now what I'm saying is the hidden layer, we're still mapping inputs to outputs, but the representation in the middle, these hidden layers, I should say more than one, but the hidden layers are receiving two kinds of input. They receive input from the actual pattern that's coming along at this moment in time, but they also receive input which is a copy of themselves a moment ago. So in that way they're able to capture structure in time. In principle, they could learn to use their weights to model temporal processes, right? It's not a done deal that this is going to work, but that's the idea. Sort of minimal model of a system that could model sequences. Okay, so you can think of it like that, or you can unroll it over time. I think this is a good way to think of it. So that's just the same picture unrolled over time, and you can see that that is is a like a deep net. If I try to propagate an error signal, something's gone wrong here, and propagate that all the way back, it's got to come back to change that weights matrix. It's got to propagate through a whole lot of weights matrices. It's a deep learning problem. So we're only unrolling here. We're not. These weights are all copies. The A matrix or whatever is going on in the A box is the same at all time. All right. So it has been pointed out that this really generalizes the family of what sorts of things you can learn. So here's the old input goes to output. I'm sorry, it's back the other way around now. Input at the top, the output at the bottom. That's one-to-one, standard old feed-forward network, if you like. But with this temporal process, each one's unrolled here, we can imagine a one-to-many mapping. That's like I say perhaps a signal, a word, making a sequence. Here's the opposite. You could take a sequence and map it to a single value, such as classifying a sequence. Who is the speaker, or what are they saying? Many-to-many is also possible. So this is what's going on in, perhaps Google Translate, which is taking in a sequence, and then having had the whole sequence, it's now got to generate a new sequence. And the most general one, I guess, is many-to-many. So a streaming input coming along, that's the red squares all through time, and we're having to produce outputs all through time as well. All right, so lots of possibilities, lots of scope for fun. Here's one rendition picture of the fundamental element inside one of these recurrent nets. So what we're taking is, it looks more complicated than it is probably. Well, all we do is we take the input, and let's think of two paths through this. So one is that the input is going to the output, and on this picture it's going through two layers of neural net, right? So that's a two-layer neural net going from input to output, and this is going to be replicated over time. So there's a whole bunch of these strung together, if you like. So the other path going through here is left to right, and that's the hidden state, which we might as well call a memory now, because it's being propagated over time. And the memory is able to pass from memory at time t to memory at time t plus 1, being changed along the way. And it's changed in the light of the current input. So you take the memory, you take the input, that changes the memory. And here's the memory influencing how input maps to output. So it's got the bare minimum. Okay. This has a bunch of problems. So it seems like this is sensible way to start. Unfortunately, it doesn't really work very well. One problem is it has this exploding vanishing gradients problem, but there's more to it than that. Very early on, in the 1990s, an alternative architecture was proposed, which is called the long short-term memory, or LSTM. And here's a picture of it, and you can tell me how it works. The interesting thing is it's pretty much inscrutable, but incredibly successful. So this is my second missing. Why is this thing working so well? So LSTM, long short-term memory, looks like this. I'm not even going to try and tell the story, but if you spend enough time with someone who really knows their stuff, you can start to believe bits of this thing make sense. But it's hard to, that's not the same as saying it's the answer, or I don't know. There's something really weird about this, that it's so successful. Okay, it's been such a long time. In 1997, so it's 20 years old. Incredible. This thing is still the state of the art in recurrent neural nets. Varieties of it, slight tweaks, admittedly, but basically this idea. So Google's translation engine runs with a whole bunch of these. Speech recognition, state-of-the-art speech recognition. All kinds of cool tech that it's either on your browser or on your phone, or is coming soon. Built out of these things. And let's just look at some examples. So here's a language model. I feed one of these recurrent neural nets everything Shakespeare ever wrote. And then, let's just jump back that picture back there. Okay, I'm feeding it characters, individual characters from, in this scenario, More like that one. Individual characters, you know, C, A, T, oh, that's not a good example. B, A, S, and then I'm trying to predict, the network is being trained to predict the next letter. Okay, so it has a little window, it's just got a sliding window, and it predicts the next letter. Fine, that's a predictor. I can train it. And then just for kicks, I'm running that model, and when it says K for the new prediction, I'm just writing K in. So now it's able to just write text forever. Okay? So this is making up Shakespeare. And if you have a look at it, I don't know, it's not that bad. It's a bit hard to see the bigger picture. But it's pretty cool. I mean, it's making words. It's making spaces. It's grammatical sentences. And look, it has the feel right. Lots of fun. This is trained on a few hundred essays by someone called Paul Graham, founder of Yahoo Store. You can tell just by looking at the fake text coming out of this generator, the sorts of things that Paul Graham writes. Yeah. Huge fun. If someone wants to ask me a question later, I can show you some fake maths. It's really fantastic. So they got the whole LaTeX of a big book and trained it up, and then they ran the model. They got a whole bunch of LaTeX that actually compiled, which means you can make a PDF out of it and look at the proofs. They're junk proofs, and you've probably seen Deep Jump. This is a Twitter account trained on all Donald Trump's tweets, and it just generates tweets all day long, you know, stuff like this, but they're pretty good. Actually fantastic. Okay. All right, what other things can we do? Heaps, that's just the start. That's just the language stuff. You can now take an image and push it to a sentence. So instead of taking this image and putting labels on it, we'll take that representation, the low-level representation of the image, and ask one of these recurrent neural nets to make plausible sentences from it. Incredibly, this works. You wouldn't think it would work, but it works pretty well. It's a man in a black shirt playing guitar. It's true. So these are slightly cherry-picked examples, but it's pretty effective and getting better all the time. So it's taking the whole system end to end, so taking a raw picture, raw image, and it's generating the text at the far end, and it's all just neural nets all the way along, trained from lots of examples. There's nothing else in there. Okay, sentence to sentence. This is just a picture to remind myself to say that the what's inside Google's Translate technology now is just a big hierarchical, multi-layered LSTM network. That's what's inside it. Up until last year, they used to have all kinds of clever linguistic machinery in there, developed painstakingly over years and years and years. It was a huge thing. And then last year, they swapped it out because this worked better. And this is just one end-to-end thing, right? It's just a whole bunch of those recurrent neural nets. All right, the one on the bottom right is taking a sentence and making an image out of it. It is extraordinary that this works. Early days as well, but if you can see them, this has seen a lot of pictures of birds, okay? And then it's been given a sentence. This small bird has a pink breast and crown and black primaries and secondaries, and it makes some images of birds.
How long has it been doing this?
This is last year. I think it's either early this year or last year. Yeah. Okay, so text to handwriting. Let me show you this. This is fun. This is... someone needs to give me a sentence. I don't know. Okay, so it's taking text. This was really came from someone trying to build a model that should recognize handwriting, but in reverse. Oh, I can't scroll that down. No. Can you see it at the bottom? So someone needs to give me a sentence, different samples. You can mess with them all you like, you know, have a go. A lot of fun. So that's actually generated. So the text comes in, and then a recurrent neural net is actually directing the way this is actually done, I believe, is it's directing the drawing motion of the actual writing, rather than trying to make a whole image with that sentence from scratch, is actually controlling, if you like, a virtual hand. All right. And here's someone, this is just the other day, last week, I think. This guy's, that's not great. Same idea as Shakespeare, okay? So you feed it in, it's going to predict something from the last few frames, and we're just going to take that frame and go with it and keep going. You could tell how this was trained. It's trained on a train. It must be. That completely, you know, new countryside. It's not perfect, but it's pretty amazing. Let's go to the town.
So you did say it had a little bit of input off the scenery before it started.
How was it kicked off? I'm not sure. For the Shakespeare one, you can kick it off with a blank space, and it just says, okay. So I'm not sure. Maybe it's kicked off with a picture, but maybe it's just starts making stuff up. I don't know. Okay. Where's that going? I just, like I say, we're going to start mistrusting our eyes, or I don't know. The world's going to get interesting. So here's something that's missing. I feel this is missing, at least. What's so great about LSTM? They're almost impenetrable, in that it's very hard to tell a story in a pub about how the LSTM works. It's a sort of three-pint explanation. It's really hard. You can pick out bits. Well, this is kind of doing it. But there's not that very simple story that I was trying to tell about the basic current network. There's two things going on, right? Inputs go to outputs through a neural net, but they're mediated by the memory, and memories go to new memories mediated by the latest input. Okay, hard to tell that story. So you have to wonder, how special is the LSTM? How unique is it? So there's an interesting story here that two teams ran very large trials trying to find something alternative architecture. Okay, so they used genetic programming, which is random search, to try out all kinds of variations. So this LSTM, I've drawn it as a diagram, but it's really just five equations. So you can make up equations randomly. You can try them out on a big machine. They trained it on the Googleplex for the equivalent of, I think, about a century of CPU time equivalent, and found the LSTM and a few other things. GRU, if you know this stuff, is the other alternative, but not much, right? So basically, this is some kind of special spot, it seems, in the space that they were searching, at least. Okay, so one idea is to do genetic programming for 100 years of CPU time. Another idea is to think about it, and so we've been trying to do that. And this is work with Paul Matthews, a wonderful honor student. David Balduzzi, can't get away from him. This is last year, and this year we're pushing on with it. So essentially, we're trying to think of what's a minimalist model that's better than the old that restricted recurrent neural net, but is understandable, unlike the LSTM. So, and we're going tensors on this. So there's a mapping from input, the same story, right? So the inputs map straight to outputs. In fact, this is just an outer product. So basically, inputs are going to outputs through a one-layer neural net. It's just that we do want that to be mediated by what's in the memory. So we involve the memory by taking an outer product. But this is another way to say this is a tensor mapping. A three-way tensor takes the input and the memory and gives you a new output. otherwise known as a bilinear form, whereas a straight matrix, Waite's matrix, is just a linear form. Okay, so that's that story. And memory is going to new memory. How's that happening? Well, it's just going straight through, really. This is a little switch that says you either send this information straight through, or maybe you take the other path and you take something from the input. And this is an either-or thing. It's not binary, but it's in the 0 to 1. A mixing between what's in the memory and what is coming directly from input. It's as simple as that. So how's this decision made about which one you want to keep? This is like a bit like a read-write head, right? You can think of it like in that simple way, that this is saying, should I keep what's there or should I overwrite it with a new bit? How do you decide what to overwrite, which things should be overwritten or not? We figure that's a job for both the current input and for the memory state. So it has to be a combination of both. Let's do the same thing. So take a tensor product of the current memory and the input and put it through a nonlinearity, and that's your switch. So that's a longer story, but that's a story, okay? So this thing has some nice properties. So the gradients don't explode or vanish because basically the memory is propagating straight through here and we're just swapping stuff out or into it. It has the effect that the gradients don't explode. We're avoiding this concatenation of input and hidden states, which always happen in the other models. You sort of push inputs and hiddens together into one space where they don't really want to be in the same space. They're different entities. It's almost like a type error to do that. So we avoid that, and we use a tensor instead of concatenation. You know, it's a machine learning talk when everyone's frowning, and there's a graph like this. I guess there's a lot of talks have graphs like this, but machine learning, you've always got one. So there's the loss function, training time going left to right along the bottom. The training loss, that's the amount of error, the amount of badness going away. And as with most talks, the badness goes away on the stuff we did and stays high on the stuff other people did. Okay, so the top two lines are the LSTM actually and the GRU, which was one of those other random ones, found that it was as good as the LSTM. So ask me about this task if you want to know later, but there are tasks, very straightforward, simple memory type tasks for which this new architecture seems pretty promising. It's early days, we're still chasing this around, but there are tasks. Here's an interesting task, which we also happen to do well on. It's the task of, so here's the input pattern vertically happening over time, okay? So sequence of input patterns. What happens is, pay attention to that very last couple of rows. When this neuron comes on, I want the network to look at these other bits, sorry, these ones over here, and remember them, and to spit them back on the output when that neuron goes off again. So the last of the inputs is a sort of trigger. And it says, when it comes on, remember something. When it goes off, cough it up. And here we're doing that with three of them, right? There's three memories going in. Store that, outcomes, store that, outcomes. Store the third thing, which overlaps, actually, and then cough it up at the end. And it's not perfect. This is our model trained on gazillions of these examples. But it's having a good go. So the first pattern comes out pretty perfectly. Second one's close. Third one's actually pretty good. Not quite there yet. So work to do. But that's to be compared with the best. This is the very best of the competition, where we try to store three memories. We get three things out, and they come out at the right times. When these neurons here turn off, you get a pattern back, but it's the same pattern. So this is the LSTM, the state of the art that's inside in your phone, doing all these awesome things, all the handwriting stuff. It can't do this kind of task. So it's just a conceptual, there's something, it finds this very hard to do. We would argue our architecture finds this a really natural thing to do. And it's very like variable binding, right? So the trigger comes along, you remember some arbitrary thing, hang on to it, and then when I release the trigger, you've got to cough it up at the output. So I guess what's particularly appealing about it is that it feels like the foundation for other processes, any processes that are capable to bind one pattern to another and use like a key and then manipulate the key perhaps in some fashion and then get back the original bound item. I didn't say that well, but I guess we're optimistic and feel that this is the beginning of something interesting, bridging into a more symbolic realm for neural nets. But it's still your standard neural net, it's just got magic tensors in it. Just an even tougher task. When this bit comes on, you have to remember the bit pattern that immediately follows it on the other nodes. And then when the neuron goes off, you have to cough it up again. So same task, but now there's all this destructor stuff in the middle. That's what the hidden representation looks like, and that's the output after training. So if you're clever, you can see that pattern there is the same as that pattern there, I think. One, two, three. Oh yeah, it is. Great. So it's learned to do that. We never told it. We just trained it, gave it lots of examples in which that's the pattern. And this is a new example. All right. So I'm going to wrap up quickly. Some more missing things. We've talked about why one thing I said was missing was why the state of the art in feed-forward nets is actually the state of the art. Why is it ResNets? What are they actually doing? I argued that they're solving the shattered gradient problem. We said there is a shattering gradient problem, and they're solving it. And then I talked about why this missing explanation for why is the state of the art in recurrent neural nets, LSTM. I don't have an answer. I think because we haven't found the better thing, and pointed to direction for thinking about the better thing. I think thinking about the problem and trying to gain insight and building something that's got that is interpretable is a better way to go than randomly searching. Here's some other questions to throw out there, missing things that I'm not going to answer, or they're very much missing. Why are deep nets better than shallow ones? This is still up for grabs, actually. So there's a proof just this year, I think, or was it last year? But that relates actually to two versus three layers. It doesn't generalize. So that's wow. Why this architecture at all? Why neural nets at all? What's so special about going mush through a weights matrix and then having an element-wise non-linearity and then back into a weights, just doing that and iterating that? Why does that work so well? Why not something else? I think there's something that is coming is various ways of making forays into more symbolic style processing, but within this connectionist, within this neural net world. And I hinted at that our tensor gate idea might be, you know, one direction to take into that. But lots of other people are doing things that are to do with, for example, having external memory, having a neural net being able to read and write from external memory, this sort of thing. Having neural nets able to implement programs, that's a hot area. Lots of fun. And my pet passion, I guess, is trying to understand generative models for really complex multi-causal data. So you imagine you have some data. You look at my go-to example is a face. I say my face. What you're seeing, the pixels that are appearing on your retina, are a combination of two completely independent things. One is the physical structure of my face, where 3D, and the other is the lighting environment. And those two things are independent, completely independent, in fact, but they interact, and then you get to see the interactions. You never actually get to see a naked lighting environment. You only see lighting environments when they hit things. And you never get to see, directly apprehend 3D structure. You always have it in the context of a lighting environment or some other environment. So there are pure things out there in the world, but they get mixed, and then we see the mixtures only. Can we build a system which is able to go the other way, and having seen a lot of data, disentangle that to discover the underlying causes? That's a big, tough problem and unsolved. Dot, 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 many, many more things to come. There's a lot missing. Missing is a huge country. Thank you very much.
agree with his...
Sorry, who's...
He's written a book last year on, it's called How to Create a Mind.
Mm-hmm.
He discusses the neurons in the brain,
mm-hmm.
and that there's 12 layers, etc. And I just wanted to
I haven't read the book, right. So I don't think I can comment on that one.
And interesting today, the announcement at the Google conference today was that the future is to do with tensor art.
Ooh, no. That's all right. Someone will get there. I have a skepticism about people, the idea that you can study brains and that will, if we study individual brains enough, we'll understand entirely how they work. I think that has to be coupled with computational style thinking. How do you achieve this kind of computation? People have been... It's a bit like the analogy with flight, that you understand flight. Yeah, you look at birds and that can help, but then eventually you have to do some aerodynamics. Sorry.
Yep.
Sorry, back to the tensor-gated
unit. Yes.
You said that it's a good thing that you don't concatenate the inputs and the previous instead.
Right.
Can you elaborate this to flight errors?
Okay, so I would direct you to David Balduzzi's paper called Strongly Typed Neural Nets. Strongly typed is the key phrase. So his point is when I map a hidden, so there's a mapping from the hidden state to the new hidden state. It's being achieved by this weights matrix. So what's the weights matrix doing actually? It's rotating and skewing directions, right? That's what it's doing. There's like a basis associated with that. Transformation. And the basis for that is a different basis from that associated with the input pattern. The interaction between the input and the hidden layer, that's a separate... it's a separate basis. It's why would you expect the hidden unit's dynamics to be naturally mapped onto... to be naturally altered just by additive changes being coming in from the input. It's a very limiting way to do things. And have a look at David's paper about strong typing. I think he can explain it.
Excellent question.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Sorry, I'm just curious about the
when you were showing the images that were generated, when the computer was taking sentences and generating images from it.
Yes.
Are those images completely new, or is it using information from previous images?
This is the sentences to images.
Yes.
The images are... in theory, they're supposed to be brand new, because they are projecting from this space of the sentence down to a much more modest latent space, does that make sense? Low-dimensional space, and from that space generating... the image, so in theory they're new images. In practice, have a read of the paper. They're struggling. So this is last year, and you look for GANs, generative adversarial networks, another kind of generative model. They do seem to suffer from a problem. It's called mode collapse, where the generative model learns to only produce a very narrow range of birds, yeah, kind of all rather similar. So that was a problem. It seems to have been solved to some extent recently. So I expect there'll be much more convincing demonstrations of that soon. But no, the whole idea is that they're not supposed to be just stuff you've seen. After all, that would be kind of boring. So most of these papers, what they do, and they should do, is test. So they're making up, generating new things. They should look at those new things and compare them to items in the training set. And usually there's some kind of demonstration that, yeah, we're really making new things.
Thank you.
Mm. Hi. Sorry, which one? Let's go with you.
Yeah, okay, fine. Thank you, first. Sorry about my insufficiency last night. I studied 7 years, so 30 years ago, when you were a science graduate. Okay, just a weird question that came up in discussion with somebody who's from a medical background a few months ago. Is it, ignoring the ethical issues, is it within current technology to cut through the optic nerve of an animal and attach it to some device that can get the signal into it?
Not my field of expertise, I would say to that. Can you chop the eyes off something and stick it onto the brain or something else? Not currently doable and not something I'm an expert on. What was the question here?
admittedly, I don't know much about biological neurons.
Yeah.
I was wondering if there are any models or approaches that get around the backpropagation, that mechanism of backprop and gradients seems kind of inappropriate for artificial neural networks.
I know, it's annoying, isn't it? It's hugely annoying that there's all this progress and cool stuff, and it's all built with bat propagation, and bat propagation is biologically implausible. So that's a damn shame for the idea that you might think about computation and make your way back towards brains and understand ourselves better. Bit of a blow. There is, various people have tried to think of alternatives, which are generally the efficiency goes down. I think it's still a live question. All this stuff is working very nicely, it just brings the pressure on. So how's it done by real neurons then? It's still an open question.
You know about the whole type of equation?
Yes.
I've never managed to get my head around this concept of layers in neural networks. Vague understanding is that you have inputs, you have a set of weights that you can tweak, and you tweak the weights so as to get the outputs to match some desired output as possible. What is the point of dividing the structure of these weights, dividing it up into layers? What do you get out of that? I mean, it must improve the efficiency somehow, but how and why?
Yeah, well, I think we're back there. I think the same thing. I don't know. You can tell a story about very shallow nets like that. Imagine a single layer is not going to be up to much, because mathematically what each neuron is doing is drawing a hyperplane in the input space and saying I'm going to be on for this side and off for that side, and hyperplanes can't do much that's very interesting. And then hyperplanes into that space, so a two-layer architecture, can make shapes that are much more interesting than hyperplanes. There's a proof that if you make a second layer, if you make just a two-layer architecture wide enough, enough hidden nodes, then you can approximate anything, but it does have to be very, very wide. It's not well understood what extra depth adds. And I guess how important is it to have it in layers? Probably not that important. You know, if I understand the question, these ResNets are really a break with that strict layer-wise thinking. They have these skip connections, and you can think of multiple paths through the network, some of which go through many layers, some of which jump over whole layers.
A big complex image is going to be made up of small images. Face is going to have eyes, nose, mouth. They have separate images, and then they've got to be put together.
Yes, yeah, well, that's a good argument for visual examples, at least. Yeah.
Okay, last question.
Okay, I get it. Okay, so I look at a sequence of slides, and there's a kind of trend or something that I see. So I'm going to make a statement, you can tell me what you think, okay?
All right.
So I look at this and I see that you have this deep neural nets, and you've applied it to a variety of, not you, but the community itself has applied it to a variety of problems. But the cases where it doesn't do well, right? Like your Shakespeare example or your other example, are things where it has to somehow represent some deeper cognitive, some sort of knowledge, which Shakespeare is not just about words, right? It's cool to see it's pure Shakespeare in words, but it's not making sense even for Trump. This neural deep net is not well suited for doing some kind of deep cognitive skills that humans are very good at. This is just doing connectionist stuff. It is not sort of capturing say, like, you know, how we reason at multiple levels, at multiple steps, and stuff like that. It's a standard neural net or a deep net is not going to do that, which is why in certain kinds of problems it doesn't do that.
Okay, and what's the question? I mean, I'm going to agree with you. So you're pointing out this, yeah. So deep nets, they're for the language example, the deep jump.
I would say that there we're just stretching it and we're being silly to even assume that it would do well because that's a wrong task to apply a deep network for.
Okay, yeah, it's a demonstration of that the neural network is at least able to capture very long correlation structure in temporal data. That's
making no sense, right? And my comment, I'm asking you if you would agree that because we are applying it to a problem that is standard pattern recognition problem,
yeah,
that's super. For tasks which require deeper body research, like, you know, multi-level reasoning stuff, probably not real super.
Well, it's hard to say. Probably not worth exploring. It's I would say it's a step towards that. So yeah, there are things missing, right? For a start, there are symbolic style manipulations that humans achieve somehow. But we don't achieve them with a CPU and a register. We do it with neurons. And so I'd say that these are not there yet. There are lots to be figured out. It's not just make it big enough, train it on enough data, and it'll become conscious and actually make sense. As you point out, the Shakespeare didn't make a lot of sense. But I don't think that's the point.
It would make sense for Shakespeare.
Sorry, would what?
It is possible to make a simpler system that would make sense for Shakespeare without a deep net.
I didn't catch the end of that sentence.
It's possible to make a simpler system that would make sense with the Shakespeare.
Oh.
So, sure.
Perhaps, yeah.
You're adding memory and knowledge to our system, it's smart.
Yeah, so currently with a memory in these neural nets is the knowledge is all being stored into the weight values. And I didn't talk about it, but there's a lot of interest in systems where the knowledge is, they're also able to read and write from some kind of notion of an external memory, associative memory. It's a hot topic. It's yielding interesting things.
Okay, I think I'll draw it to a close now. Marcus can probably still answer a few
questions.
Yeah,
sure. Love to talk.
After we thank him. So thank you very much for welcoming us to your country. And it does look very big. It does seem like there's so much missing. But you know, it certainly shed light on some things that are happening in the area. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sylvia. Thank you.
We've just got one announcement.
Well, very brief thing. I'm Guy Burgess. I'm on the committee of the Auckland branch of IT Professionals New Zealand. ITP is a co-sponsor of the Gibbons Lecture Series. And so thank you, Associate Professor Frean, for your talk tonight. Just want to quickly mention that there's two events coming up next week that you can register for on the ITP website. One is, of course, the fourth Gibbons Lecture on the ethics of AI. So that's next Thursday. And next Tuesday, we are having the ITP IT Showcase event, which is also free down at the Onwinyo Wharf, 6 p.m. next Tuesday. And so if you're interested in that, it's a discussion on the future of money. And we've got representatives from the banks, Zero, Vend, talking about issues including AI and how AI is affecting and then going to impact the financial system. So you can register for that also on the ITP website.